My name is Jan. I'm the head of the MA programs in design, service design and digital ideation at Lucerne University of Applied Sciences and Arts. It's the second time that I attend EIMAD. My first time was 2 years ago as a keynote speaker. I'm very happy to be here today and present you my paper called Digital Quarantine. The presentation is subdivided into two parts. The first is presenting results of a survey that I've conducted about half a year ago, focusing the role of our design and art schools in digital transformation. And the second part is the way that the COVID lockdown accelerated digital transformation at schools of arts and design. So let's start with part one. I conducted several interviews, qualitative interviews mainly, with participants from the arts and design context, and crossed these interviews with an online survey that was based upon the same sample, but with participants all over Europe. Initially, the study was also meant to cross these results with a sample from people with a background in computer sciences. But since in March we started, or we had the lockdown, most of these people were very busy and not available anymore. So today I will focus on the results that were provided by people from the design and arts community. I started with an exploratory interview with an arts historian, and we focused the main question that what we call digital transformation is mostly driven by technologies and the tech industry, right? And what we were looking for in that first talk was how could design and art schools have a more active role and become shapers of that digital shift. And after that first interviews, three main areas emerged. And the first one was creating values through content and access to knowledge in the digital sphere, right? The second was the future of education and working together, for example, with digital platforms and tools. And the third one is the future of being human in the context of digital transformation. So based upon these three areas, I created what I call an interview map, and that was used for all the qualitative interviews that I conducted face-to-face. And altogether, it was 9 people. There were students, alumni, teachers, researchers, practitioners, artists from the sphere of arts, filmmaking, and design. And even if the sample wasn't that big, as you can see here, there was a lot of content gathered in these qualitative interviews. And what I did then is I codified all these interviews and tried to find first clusters, right, of subjects that emerged based upon these three main areas and questions. And the first clusters you can see here that were named mostly during all of the interviews were human relationships, technology and humans, inclusiveness and critical thinking and critique. And I will go deeper into them later when we cross these results with the online study. So the online survey, as I said, was focusing the same main areas, same questions, just that the sample was a little bit larger with regards to the territory, so people from UK and all over Europe. And these are the final clusters here that you can see that emerged when I crossed the results of the qualitative interviews with the online survey. And it's really interesting to see that inclusiveness and social responsibility was named first, and the future of learning second. And then you can see politics of the digital and critical thinking, the relationship between humans and technology, and human relationships themselves came third, fourth, and fifth, right? And if you read through that, through those different clusters, you can see what people said, like, for instance, people were wishing a healthy relationship between humans and machines, or what we call the digital transformation only applies to a small part of the world's population. So many people are dealing with very different problems here, right? So that were the first results of this study that is meant to be crossed with another sample with people from a computer sciences background. And let's go to, or the main finding here is that whereas mostly we think that the digital transformation is about adopting digital technologies, really people confirm that it's much more about inclusiveness, about critique of these emergent technologies and the use of these technologies, as well as the human factor still is one of the main focuses here. let's go to part two and then kind of try to put them both together. So you might be all familiar with different responses to the lockdown that happened all across Europe and the world at universities. So one is rapid adoption of video conferencing tools, the increase of asynchronous and communication and peer learning, for instance. And in our case, we based our learning process a lot on debriefing. And sometimes always people start imitating analog formats, like they would try to meet for a virtual coffee break or something like that. And today, since we don't have that much time, I would like to focus on one part of our shift towards distance learning at Lausanne University of Applied Sciences and Arts, and that's what I call the distance learning blueprint. So at my MA programs, I developed this blueprint that was meant to help educators to reconfigure their classes for online formats, right? And as you can see here, it's meant for a two-day course, because mainly at our MA programs, the spring courses are all about 2 days. And as you can see here, I subdivided this blueprint or this chart into the lower part, where you can see anything that happens asynchronously, so where people don't meet live, and the synchronous part at the top of the diagram, where people have a live session, for instance, via a video chat or another chat tool, right? And as you can see, if we zoom out here, we tried to keep that lower part as small, the upper part as small as possible. And why was that? Live sessions can be very tiring. They need a lot of concentration. Students reported back that more than 45 minutes is nearly impossible to keep being concentrated on the screen. And also they require high bandwidth. So we try to shift everything down to the lower part, where people can work in small groups, maybe use existing repositories on the internet, such as video lessons, to learn together, what we call peer learning. Another format could be screencast, such a one that I'm recording right now, send it to the students, or some of my colleagues even send out little parcels with kits to their students, where they could, let's say, for instance, design a lamp or an interaction design kit or something for similar. So if you're interested in that blueprint, it's available on my website, or you can also contact me. And let's go to the last part of this presentation, trying to kind of see the parallels between part one and part two. So for many years, schools of arts and design really have been kind of like a self-quarantine when it comes to digital. I mean, we've been using screencast, flipped classroom, and some of these things, but not in the scale that is required right now. And most of the time, or the study at the beginning, was really trying to focus on the question how schools of arts and design could become pioneers or shapers of this digital shift. And now it turned totally to the opposite, like the COVID crisis really shaped our way to deal with that situation, right? However, I think when I think of some of the webinars in the past few weeks, or conferences such as the ALEA or Cumulus conferences that have been held online, most of the schools of arts and design tried to react very positively and actively on that lockdown, right? And there is some parallels, however, and I think one of the most parallels between what we are experiencing right now and what were the first results of my study is that is a huge increase in social responsibility. So there's the collective responsibility amongst learners and educators to deal with that situation and deal with it actively and creatively. And I think that is my main takeaway from this situation. I would really wish to kind of transition or take this with me or with us, even when the lockdown is finished and we turn back to conventional learning again. So obrigado, thank you very much. If you have any questions, contact me via email, or you can also go to my website, where all these informations and the presentation will be available, and the digital distance learning blueprint included. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, Jan. It was a very interesting presentation. Very good contribution to the state of things that we live together now. Although isolated in each house, in each country, we all share the same concept that we still don't know what to get from it. Probably in the next months we'll know exactly and in more conscious perspective what is happening to us as human beings. Thank you very much for your contribution.